You can see we've got much more helpful looking messages this time.
Found shell, that looks good.
And that should have done it. There you go, there's root.
Hey, that is great. Much easier.
Now, normally in the three-way handshake, you know, you say, hey, I want to connect. The computer you want to connect to says, sure, go ahead and connect. And then you acknowledge that connection. But with this parameter, it's not going to do that last part. And so it's kind of like a little bit stealthier because it never finished the connection. The port's not going to think that you connect.
Everyone, David Bumble here with another very special guest. Alex, great to have you on the show.
It's good to be here.
You've got a really cool demo, so I'm going to let you take it away. So what are you going to show us today?
Today we're going to be learning Metasploit.
Brilliant. So is it like a beginner's-like introduction to Metasploit?
This is going to be, yeah, a beginner's course. This is what I'm doing here at Zero Trust World. And we're just kind of showing the capabilities. And the hope is that once you see how easy it is to do some of these hacks, you're going to secure yourself against these sort of things.
So you are going to show us a bunch of things, including cracking passwords, right?
Indeed.
Brilliant. Okay, Alex, I'm going to let you take it away. I'm going to keep quiet now. Go for it.
All right, we're in Kali Linux here. And this is what we're going to be using to demonstrate most of the demo here. We've got a Metasploitable VM running. We're using Oracle VirtualBox to run these VMs. What we need from the Metasploitable box here is just the IP address, which is the 192.168.56.102. And that's going to tell us that we can hack this box at that IP address. Now, Metasploit is a collection of modules that's written by ethical hackers and penetration testers to automate exploiting particular vulnerabilities and using different payloads once they've exploited those vulnerabilities. Metasploitable is a virtual machine that is used to test all of the modules in Metasploit. We're using Metasploitable 2. It's a Ubuntu server virtual machine, and it has no GUI. So it's just all text.
This is all free, right? I don't have to buy something to do what you're doing?
Correct. Kali Linux is freely downloadable, and so is Metasploitable 2. Metasploitable 3 is a bit more difficult to configure, so we're kind of just ignoring that for today.
Great.
All right, so now that we know the IP address, we're going to go back into Kali Linux here. And the first tool that we're going to learn how to use is called Network Mapper.
Yep.
But we just call it Nmap, if I can spell it correctly. And we're just going to use the ST parameter here. That's going to be that's going to tell us to use a TCP connection to scan the ports on that machine. And you can see I've already typed it in there, so I'm just going to finish that here and run that scan. And it gives us a bunch of information really quickly here. The very first piece of information that it gives us is that TCP port 21 is open, and that's a FTP one. So the next tool that we're going to use is called Netcat, and we're going to connect to that machine on port 21. So we've just typed in the same IP address and we're specifying port 21. And when we connect there, the only piece of information it gives us is that it's running a very secure file transfer protocol daemon. That's what VSFTP stands for. Now, this particular version of VSFTP was replaced on their official website with another version that contained a backdoor.
Oh, wow.
So we're going to exploit that backdoor here by logging in. And we're going to type in user so that we can type in a username. And we can type in any username here. I always like to type in DZ is best because she is. The only thing that matters here is that it ends in a smiley face, a colon and a closed parenthesis. Whatever your username wants, there are limitations on what the username can be. Like it can't be too long or too short. Sometimes it won't work. If that happens, you just try again. And it'll tell us it wants the password. We have to type the word in pass, hit space, and we can type in any password. I'm going to use the most secure password I know. All right. We hit enter. Nothing happens. And the reason nothing happens is because that username and that password doesn't exist on Metasploitable by default. However, because our username ended with the smiley face, it's now opened a port for us. So if I control C to get out of there, we're going to go back to using Network Mapper here.
Can I just ask a dumb question, right? That thing with the smiley face, is that the backdoor that they put in the software?
It is.
So the developers put their own backdoor?
No. It was someone malicious. It was quickly caught.
Yep.
But it was downloaded because they thought it was funny.
Yeah.
And so it's preserved and they put it in here to test against.
Nice.
So we're going to use our nmap command again, and we're going to change from ST to SS. And what that's going to tell us is to do an incomplete TCP scan. Normally in the three-way handshake, you know, you say, hey, I want to connect. The computer you want to connect to says, sure, go ahead and connect. And then you acknowledge that connection. But with this parameter, it's not going to do that last part. And so it's kind of like a little bit stealthier because it never finished the connection. The port's not going to think that you connected. So we're going to specify port 6200 here. And what that's going to do for us is tell us if that port is now open. And of course, I forgot to run this command as root. So we're going to sudo that. The password on Kali is Kali. Spoilers. All right. And it tells us that it is open. Now, in my testing, I found that once you connect to this port, it closes the port. You know, so it doesn't remain open. But because we're doing it stealthy, if I do it again, it shows that it is still open. And so that lets us know that we can then connect to that. So we're going to go back to Netcat. And instead of port 21, we're going to do port 6200. Now, you notice it didn't tell us that it's running any protocols because it's not. It appears to have done nothing, but it's logged us in. And if we do ID, we can see that it's logged us in as root. So we now have root access to this machine.
Via the backdoor on that FTP server, right?
Yep. And we can see the IP address from the IPA command is our Metasploitable VM and not ours. So we're going to exit out of there. And if I do my IP address, you can see that I'm 56.5. So we know that that wasn't my machine.
So you've just got root access on that VM.
Correct.
By FTP.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
So now we're going to do the same thing, except this time we're going to use Metasploit. So the command to launch that is msf console, or you can use the start menu if you'd like, and that takes some
moment. Yeah, so the first way you did it is the hard way. Now you're going to do the easy way.
Yep. I'm going to show you just how much easier Metasploit makes that exact attack. So we're going to search for it. Very secure file transfer protocol daemon. And we can see it's got a couple modules there. We're going to use this excellent ranked one here. So we're going to use one. We're going to show the options here. And the only option that we need to set is the R host, the remote host, because it's required and it does not have a current setting. All right, so now that we're in the module, you can see we've got the red text here letting us know that we're in the exploit module for that. We are going to set the R hosts. And I have to remember that this is plural, even though we're only doing one.
Yeah.
And we're going to use that IP address from earlier, the same one. So now it's set. And that's pretty much it. Then we just hit run. And this is all automated. Takes a moment. It doesn't always work the first time. But the cool thing is we can just run it again.
I think that's the thing that you need to learn when you're attacking devices, right? It's not always going to work. And it's not always going to work the first time.
You can see we've got much more helpful looking messages this time.
Found shell. That looks good.
And that should have done it. There you go. There's root.
Hey, that is great. Much easier.
Now now we've exploited it. What are some things that we can do with it? Well, we could shut it now since we don't need it for the rest of the demo there.
Oh, shut down. I like that. I thought that was like some special command. So you're shutting the VM down, right?
Yeah. And if we look at the VM here, we can see that it's stopping all of the services that it's running and it is going to shut down. So if you were running a web server and someone did that to you, you'd probably not appreciate it.
Yeah, I mean, it's a basic proof of concept, right? Because you could have done something much more malicious.
Yeah, and we'll look at some of the malicious stuff
next.
All right, the next exploit that we're going to take a look at is Eternal Blue.
My friends at the NSA, right?
Yeah. It was developed by the NSA back in 2017 is when they made it public. They notified Microsoft that they noticed that someone that was not them was exploiting it in the wild. Microsoft patched it in March. And in April, we were hit with the WannaCry virus, which used Eternal Blue. And the scary part about that is that it affected all versions of Windows that didn't have the March patch. So a lot of companies were still using Windows XP because why not? You know, there's no reason to upgrade. Well, this was the nail in the coffin for a lot of those old OSs, because if you didn't get the March patches, which were only for the most recent ones, you were vulnerable to this and it would encrypt all of your files and it wouldn't give them back. So to do that, we're going to just search for Eternal Blue, no space. And there's a few modules here. The one that we're going to use today is that first one. All right, now I've got a VM running here that's running Windows 7 that is vulnerable, but you know, I don't remember the IP address of that. So we're going to go back actually to Nmap. And we're going to see if we can find out what that IP address is based on the information that we have. We know it's on the network. So we're going to just tell Nmap here to scan the entire subnet rather than giving it a particular IP address. and it should tell us what the IP address of that machine is. There we go. It is 106. So now that we know the IP address, if we show the options in the exploit that we're in, and it's cool that you can use Nmap inside of Metasploit there, we can see that, again, we need to set the R hosts because it's required and it's not set. One other setting that we're going to have to set is the listening host, because we want that to be on the same network as the machine that we're exploiting. So it's a good thing that I checked our IP address earlier. If I scroll way far up, we can see here that it was .5. So our listening host is going to be .5, and our remote host is going to be 106 for this. So set our hosts.
That's the device you're attacking, right?
Yep, this is the remote host, and that one is 106. We're going to edit that to .5, and we're going to change it from plural to singular, and from remote hosts to listening hosts. There we go. So L host. And then once we've got those set, we just run. Yep. We get a lot of interesting text there. This is a very complicated hack. So to do this manually would involve more steps than we have time for. And you can see at the very end, we didn't quite get a win message, but we did get a meterpreter prompt, which means that we're now in that machine. So what can we do? We can do LS.
Config or something, because it's Windows, right?
Oh, right. We can do dir is the one. No, it's not letting us. There we go. So it shows us, we've got a lot of things in there, probably because we're in system32. .exe, that's not something you'd see on Linux. So we know that we're inside the Windows source here. So how could we take advantage of the fact that we've just broken into this machine? Well, let's do a hash dump. And there we have the hashes for all of the users on the machine. It's that easy. So we're going to copy these. I'm going to open up a new terminal window here, and I'm going to make the text a little bigger. And you can see I might have done this a few times here. My password hashes seems like a great name for a file. It's going to open that up. Oh, look. All right. So we've stored our password hashes in a text file. The next thing that we want to check is make sure that we've got the RockU text file unzipped onto this machine. Which I've already got, but I'll show you how to do that here. If we go to password attacks, password profiling and word lists, and then word lists, it's going to open up a new window here. And normally when you open this, it'll ask you if you want to extract the RockU text file. I've already done it, so it didn't ask me, but it is right there. We can see it here. And importantly, it tells us what directory we're in for these word lists. RockU was a company that made MySpace games way back in the day. They had about 32 million users at the time of this breach. They decided that it would be a good idea to store all of those username and password combinations in a SQL database that was 10 years out of date, and to store them in plain text.
Very, very clever.
So it was no surprise that, it was breached and it was on the internet. And since then, it's become the most well-known collection of passwords on the internet, which is why it's included here in Kali Linux. I believe RockU went bankrupt in 2019, I want to say. So we've got a word list just full of, I think, 17 million unique passwords. And we're going to use that when we use John the Ripper here to brute force our way against those hashes to see which passwords in the word list match those hashes. All right. So we're going to use John. And John the Ripper is just a password cracker. Type in John to tell it to use John the Ripper. We'll just complete that here. You can see that we specify the word list, including the directory that the word lists are in. It's the RockU text file is what we're using. We supplied it with the name of my unique password hashes text file.
That you grabbed from that Windows computer.
Yep. And the format of these passwords is going to be NT. That means Windows. It stands for new technology. It was
a new technology many, many years ago.
Microsoft was using at the time, and it's just stuck. And when we do that here, we can see it's that quick. Just took a couple of seconds, and we can see that the users on that machine, their passwords are right there, and there's no admin password. So this is why you've always been told don't use a word in the dictionary as your password, a single word.
Yep.
It's a good idea to use multiple words, like maybe a whole sentence, because that is much harder to crack, because then you have to start combining words together, and there's spaces and punctuation. And that's the reason that, you see all these funny password requirements, like has to have a number and a special character and all that, because it makes it harder for this type of attack.
Yep.
One of the interesting things that I like to mention at the end here is that if you go back and you watch, like, for example, Overkill Gaming's video for our Control Alt Pwn competition, they invited four hackers in to try to hack into one of these machines, and one of them was going to win the machine if they hacked in. And every single one of them used Nmap to start, and then used Metasploitable to hack that machine. So now that you've seen this and you can identify these tools, it's interesting to see where they pop up. In fact, in my research, I found there's a special page on Nmap's homepage that just lists all of the movies that Nmap has been in.
That's cool.
So it's good to see all the different places it's at.
So Alex, you got to tell us a bit about yourself, right? You work for ThreadLocker, is that right?
Indeed. I'm a special projects engineer. Special projects being anything Danny wants on that particular day, including creating a hacking lab for Metasploit.
So you present this at Zero Trust World, and does ThreadLocker provide this kind of training as well to help people better secure their networks?
This wouldn't be something we would specifically provide. This is just an example of what it is that we're up against.
Yeah.
You saw how easy it was for me to infiltrate those machines, and the whole reason was they weren't patched. They had vulnerabilities, known vulnerabilities. And so we always encourage our customers to patch as soon as they're able to in their environment. You definitely should test those patches first, but then get them implemented, because a favorite technique of cyber criminals is to read the patch notes.
Yep.
And once they've done that, they say, oh, that's an interesting thing that they've patched there. I wonder if I could exploit that on a machine that doesn't have the patch. And if they are able to do that in a reasonable amount of time, then all they need to do is look for machines that haven't patched yet.
I mean, you raise a good point there, because a lot of people watching this might say, because you get the YouTube comments like, this is dumb because you're showing an old computer. But we both know that just because a patch has been released doesn't mean it's implemented even for a long time, right?
Yep. Eternal Blue is still being used in the wild today, because there are a lot of places that just still use old technology and aren't aware of the risks to doing so.
So Alex, I've got to ask you, are you on social media? Is there somewhere where someone can connect to you?
I tend to stay off of social media because I work in cybersecurity. The final Easter egg that I have for you here is something called No More Secrets.
Yep.
You might recognize the movie that it's from. It's just a flashy little script that you can get from GitHub. And we've already used the IPA command to see what our IP address is. But you can see if we tell it to pipe it into No More Secrets, it's all encrypted at first, and then it slowly decrypts.
Right.
Because, you know, people coming into the hacking lab, they expect a little bit of flash.
So, Mr. Robot, one of your favorite shows?
I've actually not seen that one.
Dude, you can't be a hacker and not watch Mr. Robot. No, I'm kidding. Alex, when you're not hacking, what do you do? Is it gaming? Do you watch TV? What do you do?
I am a gamer, yes. Path of Exile! By the way, today is League Start in Path of Exile, and I'm stuck here at Zero Trust World. ThreatLocker said I had to come in.
Your priority's all wrong, right?
I was going to run a marathon, but no, ThreatLocker said I had to come in to Zero Trust World. That's right, you heard it. ThreatLocker stopped me from having ran somewhere.